A major shakeup has taken place over at Disney and Marvel Studios. In the power structure over at Marvel, President Kevin Feige has reported to Marvel Entertainment CEO Ike Perlmutter for approval on projects. Word is that the relationship between Feige and Perlmutter has been a tense one, as Perlmutter has turned down several of Feige's ideas and initiatives and almost shut down the storyline idea for Captain America: Civil War. However, according to a report from The Hollywood Reporter, Feige will no longer be reporting to Perlmutter, but will rather be reporting directly to Disney Studios chief Alan Horn, apparently giving Feige more freedom in running Marvel films. John, what do you think the repercussions will be of this move?
This is actually really fascinating. Now, I know a lot of times average film fans aren't all that interested, and understandably so, about what goes on at the corporate offices of these big movie studios, but this is significant. Now, we've tried to mention throughout, you know, whenever we do the show that, you know, there's this image that Kevin Feige is like the king. He's got the crown on his head and he's sitting on there, and whatever Kevin Feige wants, he gets over at Marvel since he's the president. And we've often mentioned on the show that he's got people he's got to answer to, that he has to, when he has an idea, he's got to go get permission to do. And he's got several levels of people above this. Perlmutter, here's the thing about Perlmutter. He is notoriously frugal. That's a polite way of saying cheap. He is notoriously frugal. I kid you not, this is absolutely true. Now, when the press goes to like press junket days, quite often what happens at these press junkets, I know Ashley's been to several of these press junkets as well. What happens is they'll book a hotel or something, a whole floor of a hotel. You show up. Now, as a press person, you normally have to, you can be there from anywhere from 3, 4, 5, 6. I've been there 8 hours. Whew. for some junkets. Like, they can be really long days where you're not getting any of your other work accomplished. You got to be there to do these press junket interviews and stuff like that. Now, what will often happen is studios, they will set out a hospitality suite. Well, they'll have catered food in there. They'll have lots of different types of drinks, you know, to keep it comfortable since they need you to be there all day to cover and promote their movie. Well, Perlmutter, you'd think Marvel films, right? The biggest box office films out there, blah, blah, blah. You know what Perlmutter did? He said, food for the press? What? Screw that. And literally, they were too cheap to book out a hotel for things. So they just have now the Marvel press days just at Disney Studio lot on this one very not laid out well floor where it's totally cramped. There's nowhere to sit down. You're standing around for 4, 5, 6 hours waiting to get your 3-minute interviews. And they're like, soda? He once complained. Why are we giving the press 2 sodas? They don't need more than one. So you know what he did to solve the problem? He eliminated it altogether. No drinks. This just little cheap dollar store bottled water. There, you can have some bottled water. What about food? We got people. They don't need food. Some of them are here for like 7 hours. Okay, fine. Pour a bowl of Doritos. I'm not kidding. They put out a big bowl of Doritos, and then they order in 3 kinds of Subway sandwiches, and that's it. Now, this is just reflective of the mentality Perlmutter has brought to the whole thing. He is notoriously tight-stringed on the wallet when it comes to how much they spend on the Marvel movies as well. There's been a lot of talk about how, you know, a lot of the stars of the Marvel films don't necessarily make the money you would think they would make doing those types of movies, right? And Kevin Feige, he's been the wall that Kevin Feige has to go to and seek permission from and approval from and all that kind of stuff. One of the interesting things about this move, though, with Feige now getting kind of a de facto promotion now, because now he gets to bypass Perlmutter and go straight to Alan Horn, the head of Disney Studios, and probably also Bob Iger, who is like the Lord High King of all things Disney. So now there's less layers of management between Kevin Feige and the top. This will give Kevin Feige more freedom to do a lot of things he wants to do and all that kind of stuff. The interesting thing here, though, is that Jeff Loeb, I think that's the proper pronunciation of his name, who runs Marvel television division, so Daredevil, Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., Agent Carter, and all the upcoming shows as well. He is still going to be directly reporting to Perlmutter. So now you've got Feige, who's not reporting to the Marvel CEO. He's going directly to Alan Horn, but Jeff Loeb is still directly reporting to Perlmutter. I suspect this signals more and more of a separation between the Marvel movie universe and the Marvel television universe. Especially since you got the heads of those two bodies now reporting to completely different people. That's going to be interesting to see how that evolves as time goes on. But here's the big thing for me, and I'm really curious to know what your guys' thoughts on this are. I'm reading around the internet, and I understand a lot of people cheering this move that Kevin Feige now doesn't have to report to Perlmutter, he goes straight to Disney, blah, blah, blah. And everybody's cheering it, and everybody's just assuming this is a good thing. I am dubious about this. I am nervous about this. And here's why. Think what you will about Perlmutter and his cheapness and his frugalness, and turned down some of Feige's ideas, approved some, fought on others, all that. Think what you will about it. The damn team has worked. The formula up until this point of Feige having that check and balance with Perlmutter, and they've had to work together whether they've liked it or not, it's worked. The Marvel Cinematic Universe is the biggest juggernaut in the film world right now, and it's worked because of that tandem, whether or not either of them liked the tandem to begin with. I also get really nervous when you get big filmmakers like George Lucas or M. Night Shyamalan or whoever else, who the more and more autonomy they get and the more and more freedom they get, the less and less checks and balances they have or people who can say no to them, suddenly goes off a cliff. And I don't think it's any, you know, coincidence that the worst of the Christopher Nolan Batman series was the one that got made when Christopher Nolan was at the height of his power and influence, when fewer and fewer people at WB could say no to him, and that's when we got The Dark Knight Rises. I don't think Dark Knight Rises is a bad film, but I think even the most diehard of Batman fans, most at any rate, will agree that that was the worst of the trilogy. The notion that Kevin Feige is just getting less people he's accountable to, while if I was Kevin Feige, I would love it, I'm a little bit nervous about it at the same time. So I don't know. Schnepp, you read all this story and all that kind of stuff. What do you think is happening here? How do you think this is going to shake out? And is this a good or a bad thing?
Well, I think it's probably a good thing, because if you look at what Perlmutter's done really for Marvel, I mean, he's acerbated the relationship between Fox and Marvel and Disney. So Fox and Disney are like really at each other's throats. There's no Fantastic Four merchandise. There's no Fantastic Four video games. There's no anything. It's because they were like, we're not, and they're also canceled the comic. Perlmutter's like, they're messing with our, you know, they're not going to give us Fantastic Four back. Cancel their comic. He canceled, I think he even tried canceling Deadpool for a little bit, but that character's just so popular that he just kept repopulating, you know, in the comic book series. But he canceled Fantastic Four. He would have canceled X-Men if he could have. Because that's just how he's trying to, you know, squeeze them out. But that's not going to work, I don't think. But I think maybe this Feige not having to report to him could be an indication to maybe trying to open up a new way to talk to Fox.
That's a really interesting way of looking at it, Mark.
That's right, yeah. It sounds like there's also like a civil war going on at Marvel in right. addition to them actually trying to make a movie called Civil War. To me, this shows a huge confidence boost for Kevin Feige and yeah. the way that he is perceived by the top brass at Disney and at Marvel. I've never heard the name Perlmutter until you guys just started talking about him, so I can't speak to what his level of soda production is or how much he provides sandwiches for press or anything like that, or how cheap he is when it comes to making movies. You bring up a great point, though, John. They have been a successful team for almost a decade. This isn't like they made a couple good movies and now Feige wants all the control. They have been through phases of films that have all knocked it out of the park. So now, when you have Kevin Feige with all this creative control, don't misunderstand that, though, because he still has to report to somebody. And by the way, Kevin Feige, while he is the president of Marvel, isn't the guy that's actually going out and making the movies. So unlike somebody like a George Lucas, who has all the control to make whatever Star Wars movie he wanted to make, Kevin Feige still is hiring the guy who's going to go make that movie, who's recruiting the talent. Civil War is probably going to have the most comic book characters we've ever seen in one movie before. Maybe that was why they started to lock horns a little bit, is like, how many guys do you actually need in Civil War before it becomes too much? And going forward with what Infinity War Part 1 and Part 2 is going to be, that's going to break the record that Civil War sets. So maybe that's where they started to be like, I don't see eye to eye with this guy. The fact that Kevin Feige has such a proven track record, to me, this seems like a pretty safe move. If I was a fan of Marvel TV, which I'm not a huge fan of, I love Daredevil on Netflix, I don't watch Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. at all, that might make me nervous that now Perlmutter is only doing the TV. So what does that do to budget constraints? And what does that do to something going forward, like seeing the Punisher in Daredevil Season 2? And the way that Netflix creatively is going to be run from Marvel's perspective going forward, that's what would make me nervous. I have no worries at all about the future of Marvel from a film standpoint.
Yeah, and when you look at TV, because Perlmutter has applied the same principles kind of to the TV, because when you look at Daredevil, right, we often joke around, but if you watch Daredevil, as great of a show it is, you realize they made that movie for lunch money, or that show for lunch money. That's a low budget series, and they did such a great job with it. Here's another angle to think about this at. This could be an interesting way by Disney making this move to kind of give Kevin Feige a promotion without really giving him a promotion, because look at this way. Disney has got to be aware of the fact that at some point, if it's not already happening, other major studios, Fox, Warner Brothers, whoever, are going to start targeting Kevin Feige to not just have a big role, but to be their CEO. That a lot of companies are going to be looking at Kevin Feige as like, hey, how would you like to come over to Warner Brothers and oversee? You made the Marvel Cinematic Universe. Imagine your place in history now if we bring you over to Warner Brothers and you shepherd in our DC Cinematic Universe to greatness. You'll be immortal. Or if Fox does that, or if Lionsgate does that, or if Universal does that, Disney has to know at some point these companies are going to come knocking on Kevin Feige's door, and they want to do whatever they can do to keep this dude happy. So on that side too, that's probably a pretty smart
and
move.
Let's also look at the slate that Marvel has coming out. It's not nearly as known quantities as what we had before, like Iron Man and Thor and Hulk and Captain America. People were familiar with these brands, not as much so with a Black Panther or a Doctor Strange or Inhumans. So maybe this is a vote of confidence for the guy that is the chief creative consultant, and the president is Kevin Feige. They're like, we trust this guy's vision, and that we might have to differ more from the source material with these new movies than we had to previously. So maybe that's why they're like, we don't want to have any more conflict than we need.
And one other thing, though, to throw in here, you know that old saying, be careful what you wish for? Okay, so now Feige is going to be reporting directly to Alan Horn. And from all respects, Alan Horn is a very liked guy. He really is. And he's a huge fan of Kevin Feige. But let's see what happens now when Kevin's got to bring his requests and everything to Alan, and, you know, maybe it works out worse or not. We'll see how that all turns out.